four rabbis got into an argument. One rabbi gave his interpretation of the Bible, but the other three disagreed with him. The lone rabbi asked God for a sign that he was right, and behold, it began to rain. However, the other rabbis were unconvinced. They said, rain doesn't prove anything. It's only a coincidence. Again, the rabbi prayed for a sign clearer than before. A few moments later, lightning struck the tree next to them. The other rabbis were still unconvinced. They said, lightning is random and means nothing. Once more, the rabbi asked God for the clearest sign possible. Suddenly, a booming voice came from the heavens shouting, he's right. Returning to their conversation, the three rabbis stated, okay, now it's 3-2. Professor Marcus Borg wrote the book, Reading the Bible Again for the First Time, Taking the Bible Seriously but Not Literally. He begins by asserting, conflict about the Bible is the single most divisive issue among Christians in North America today. He was correct in 2001 when the book was published, and it's still true today. And that issue underlies the disaffiliations of the churches from the United Methodist Church. And the question that gets at the heart of the difference is, are there mistakes in the Bible? Some Christians say, yes. The scripture was inspired by God, but since books were written by people, there are bound to be mistakes in them. However, other Christians see the Bible as perfect. They claim that God dictated the words to the various authors of the biblical books. So if you ask them, are there mistakes in the Bible, they say absolutely not. They believe the Bible is inerrant and infallible, at least in its original manuscripts, which, of course, we do not have. How many people in this country believe in that the Bible is the literal word of God? In last year's Gallup poll, 20% of Americans say the Bible is the literal word of God. 1 in 5 Americans believes the Bible is without error. That's actually down from 24% in 2017, and about half of what it was in 1984 when 40% of Americans believe the Bible to be the literal word of God. The largest group, though, the largest group of us Americans, 49%, actually believe the Bible's inspired, but not the literal word of God. And I believe that is the best way to see the Bible. Why? Three reasons. One is it preserves the inspiration of Scripture. Two, it's an honest approach that takes the Bible as it is, rather than forcing the books of the Bible to be something that the writers never claim. Three, this is the view where Jesus' example leads us. I have a Bible that I've had for decades. Several chapters of Deuteronomy are repeated in that Bible. It was obviously a binding error at the printing company. Is that a mistake in the Bible? In 1631, King Charles I ordered the royal printers to reprint the King James Version of the Bible. They did, but there was a mistake. They left out the word not in the command against adultery. So it actually read, thou shalt commit adultery. That was certainly a mistake on the part of the typesetter. When the writer of Mark's gospel says he is quoting from Isaiah, but then he quotes from Malachi, is that a mistake? I respect everyone's right to an opinion, but to me, the inerrantist approach to the Bible is not being honest with the Bible and is not how Jesus saw his Bible. If we want to be Jesus' disciples, shouldn't we pay attention to his approach to Scripture? We've already seen in our series how Jesus had a high regard for Scripture, but he could set aside one of the Ten Commandments, the law of the Sabbath, for the sake of his hungry disciples and in order to heal people who needed healing. He could set aside the command to stone adulterers because of his compassion for a woman who had been publicly humiliated by his enemies. Clearly, Jesus did not see the scripture as perfect or without error. Let me share another example. In Mark 7, Jesus said to the crowd, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand there is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile." His disciples did not understand this. All their lives they had been eating a restricted diet based on kosher laws and the Torah. So Jesus explained it to them. Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile, since it enters not the heart but the stomach and goes out into the sewer? Thus he declared all foods clean. And he said, it is what comes out of a person that defiles, for it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Jesus declared all foods clean in direct contradiction to chapter 11 of Leviticus and chapter 14 of Deuteronomy. He said the writers of the Torah got it wrong. How did he come to that conclusion? He read the dietary laws of the Torah, studied them, and then he thought about it. It did not make sense to him to say people were considered unclean or defiled if they ate pulled pork at Sonny's barbecue. Rather, Jesus saw that people's evil motives led them to harm others, malign others, and ignore those in need. So Jesus rejected those passages in his Bible. John Wesley taught us that we Methodists are also to use our reasoning skills to interpret the Bible. Perhaps we will conclude that a passage is wrong. Is it okay to disagree with a passage of Scripture? Jesus did. And the truth is, we do it all the time by our ignoring passages, even entire books of the Scriptures. For example, Paul makes it clear in 1 Corinthians that women should not cut their hair but wear it long, and that men should not have long hair. He also gives the rule that a woman must pray with her head covered, which is why so many women used to wear hats to church. It looks like we disagree with that rule this morning. He also argues that in 1 Timothy that women should not wear gold, pearls, or expensive clothing, that they should not have their hair done up. In 1 Peter, we encounter the same rule. That's why some conservative Christians have banned jewelry, hairdos, and makeup. Personally, I think if the barn needs painting, you should paint it. Let's keep America beautiful. Of course, that could be why people keep suggesting I go back to wearing a mask, not for my health, but to improve my looks. What about Jesus' rule against divorce? Jesus says anyone who divorces and marries someone else is committing adultery. We clearly act as if that does not apply to us today. The divorce rate has been the same for Christians as non-Christians for decades. So that brings up an important point. Could it be that a law or rule represented God's will as people understood it in the historical context of thousands of years ago, but it does not represent the will of God today? How do you decide when a passage is culturally or historically bound and not applicable to us in the 21st century? In that sense, it's not so much that people were mistaken about what God wanted or how they saw God, but that our way of thinking, our culture and society are so different, we cannot accept the old way of seeing it. And we have a fascinating example of just that in the Bible in the two passages that Woody read earlier, from 2 Samuel and 1 Chronicles. The person who wrote Chronicles retold stories from Samuel and Kings in his own words. Let's look at the story. David decided to take a census of his people so he could ascertain how many fighting men were in Israel and Judah. The general Joab protested that taking such a census would be wrong. It would offend God. What was wrong with taking a census? Apparently, it showed a lack of trust in God on David's part. Even though Joab protested, he obeyed the king and counted the fighting men so that David learned that he had more than 1 million soldiers at his disposal. But Joab was right. God was offended. God punished Israel for David's sin by sending a pestilence that killed 70,000 people. It's a strange story, but the question is, why did David take the census in the first place? Samuel says, the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he incited David against them, saying, go, count the people of Israel and Judah. So the Lord, Yahweh, literally, the God of Israel, incited David to do it. Chronicles retells the story, but says Satan stood up against Israel and incited David to count the people of Israel. So did God do it, or did Satan do it? Is this a mistake in the Bible? Obviously, the chronicler is contradicting his earlier source, but why? The chronicler was writing hundreds of years after Samuel was written. Jewish culture had changed dramatically. Jewish theology had changed, probably through the exposure to Zoroastrianism. Jews began talking about Satan. The word Satan means adversary. In the book of Job, the adversary is portrayed as one of the sons of God in heaven, one of God's heavenly beings who serves the Lord. He functioned like a prosecuting attorney, pointing his finger at people who had been doing wrong and putting people to the test to see if they would remain faithful. The adversary put Job to the test with God's permission. In the chronicler's retelling of Samuel, Satan tempts David. By the way, this is the only time in the Old Testament that Satan is a name. In Job, it's merely a title, not a name. Why did the writer of Chronicles correct the thinking of Samuel? I think it's obvious. He could not accuse the good and righteous God of inciting David to do something wrong and then punishing David for what he did. Wouldn't that make God unfair and unjust? The more ancient biblical theologians, like the author of Samuel, could say that God was responsible, that God incited David to take the census, just as God had hardened Pharaoh's heart in the story of the plagues in Egypt that we read in the book of Exodus. The chronicler corrects what in his view is mistaken theology by making Satan the instigator of David's sins. To him, it seems he was saying it's better to say the devil made me do it than to say God made me do it. Today, people outside the church read the Bible. They see the contradictions and errors. They see the humanness of Scripture. If we Christians pretend that those contradictions and errors do not exist, are we being honest and faithful witnesses of Jesus Christ? Some fundamentalist Christians and some atheists say that if the Bible has even one error, it's not to be trusted. That makes no sense. I agree with Adam Hamilton in his book, Making Sense of the Bible, Rediscovering the Power of Scripture Today. He writes, people I trust are not perfect, but they are persons of integrity. They will never willfully mislead. For example, I have complete confidence in my wife. Does that mean that she is always right? Well, perhaps I should use a different example. One of the delights of being the pastor of this church is that I've gotten to know some of you well enough to know that you are persons of integrity. You may not always be right, but I know I can trust you to always have the best interests of the church and others in mind. In the church, there's only one person who is always right. And of course, that's the senior pastor. You didn't have to laugh that much now. I'm sure that's somewhere in the book of discipline. I don't know. But I agree with Marcus Borg that it's time we Christians learn to read the Bible again for the first time. It's time we take the Bible seriously, but not literally. It's time we give serious thought to what the various biblical writers say, with the freedom to dialogue with them and even occasionally to disagree with them, as our Lord Jesus did. Are there mistakes in the Bible? That's really like asking, are there mistakes in Da Vinci's Last Supper or Michelangelo's David? Yes, there are mistakes, but they do not take away from these magnificent works of art. The Bible is sacred, and reading the Bible is sacramental. The Bible is a masterpiece of spiritual art leading us to God. That is the deeper question. Can we rely on the Bible to lead us to God? Is the Bible a reliable guide for knowing the Lord and living a life in relationship with the Lord? Yes. That has been my experience and the experience of millions of Christians for the last 2,000 years. When I read the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," my heart is comforted. I am drawn to the Lord who loves us and takes care of us. When I read the promise of Jesus in John 14, "I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." I have confidence that even with all my faults, Jesus will welcome me one day because of his love and grace. Then I will embrace him and all those others who have gone on before me. Every time I read about love in 1 Corinthians 13, I am challenged. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things. Love never ends, even with our disagreements. Would to God that we would love each other that way, the way Jesus loved us and gave his life for us. Let us pray. Dear Lord, as we read the sacred scriptures, speak to our hearts. May we experience your grace. In the name of our teacher and example, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."